Tonight, a profile of the greatest rock and blues guitarist Britain has ever produced, Eric Clapton. It's over 20 years since the graffiti on the walls of London read, "Clapton is God." Since then, Eric Clapton has seemed to exemplify the unstable rock star in a long and checkered career. The dedicated blues purist of the Yardbirds and John Mayall's Blues Breakers became the guitar legend of the supergroup Cream and Blind Faith. And even when he became reclusive, losing 3 years as a heroin addict and following it with 7 as an alcoholic, he would periodically resurface with new bands of his own and occasional memorable songs. But somehow, life began again for him at 40, when in 1985 he won over a new generation of fans at the Live Aid concert, since then releasing 2 very successful albums and winning the 1987 BPI Lifetime Achievement Award. Clapton calls himself a dinosaur. Some agree. Others claim he's now at his zenith. The Clapton is God graffiti has reappeared. In Chris Hunt's Southbank Show film, we ask, what happened to the youth who was so dedicated to the early Chicago bluesmen like Big Bill Brunzer?
When did you leave heaven? How did they let you go? How's everything up in heaven? I would love to know why did you trade heaven just for these earthly things? Why did you lose your little halo, baby? Why'd you drop your wings?
People would say it's very difficult for a young white boy brought up in Surrey, England, to be so taken with and to want to take over music by black people in having come from Africa to the south of America.
I felt through most of my youth that my back was against the wall, and that the only way to survive that was with dignity and pride and with courage. And I heard that in certain forms of music. I heard it most of all in the blues, because that was an individual. One, it was always one man with his guitar versus the world. And it wasn't a company, it wasn't a band or a group or anything. It was, when it came down to it, it was one guy who was completely alone and had no options, no alternatives whatsoever other than just sing and play to ease his pain. And that echoed what I felt in many aspects of my life during that time.
Why did you trade heaven just for these earthly things? Why did you lose your little halo?
As a young guitarist, Clapton's heroes were bluesmen: Big Bill Brunzee, Lead Belly, and their 60s counterparts, the Chicago electric blues players like B.B. King and Buddy Guy. infant Clapton's mother left him with her own parents, not visiting him until he was 9.
I think that he must have known, surely my parents' name was Clap and his was Clapton, and he must have known and wondered about it even as a little boy, you know, younger than 9 even. But I probably, by my coming back to England, it made it realise it that much more. I thought he was very much a loner, which he probably was. A bit confused by me coming back, and understandably so, I guess.
He's a bit of a loner, really, to start with. And he's had an imaginary horse and all those sorts of things, you know. He'd sit on the doorstep and play with snails, and my snails would go around on the ground. But he's a lovable kid, you know, he still is, anyway.
The young Clapton was bright but withdrawn. He felt isolated by his illegitimacy and found it difficult to communicate, often preferring to listen to records or the Uncle Mac children's programme on the radio.
Every now, Uncle Mac used to play occasionally, for some reason or another, you know, a Big Bill Brunsey track or a Chuck Berry track. And those are the ones that stuck out. Instead of Pink Tink Toothbrush or whatever, or, the Runaway Train Comes Over the Hill and She Blew, which you'd get every bloody week. I mean, but every now and then he'd sling one in, and that would get me. And it was the idea of the combination of that maybe you could reproduce that somehow.
He kept on about this electric guitar that he could join a band, you see. Anyway, we said, OK. I said, well, we can't pay for that right. And he told us about bells at Kingston, so we went up there again and saw one. He picked out the one he wanted. Just signed the papers and bought it for him. From then on, he just took off, you know. But the sad part about it, before it was finished paying, he'd sold it to someone else. After our night, he'd keep us awake playing everything. He loved classical music as well as, but it was blues. Oh, blues. I love him when he plays blues, you know. He really is a blues man, I think.
I don't know how we're going to do it, but we're going to try and get together with one of my great heroes, Buddy Guy. And when he's got, if you put him on the stage with me, it's a whole chemical thing happens whereby it's like a taut string on a violin, you know. Suddenly it's...
Thank you.
you put me next to a blues player and I'm that kid again.
In 1963, the 18-year-old Clapton joined the Yardbirds.
The Yardbirds were, you know, some middle-class lads that really just wanted to have a lot of fun and get in the van and go up the M1, really. That was the main aim. The beginning of touring and girls, you know.
Clapton never felt he really belonged in the Yardbirds, set apart by his working-class background. But the Yardbirds quickly became popular, and their clean-cut look appealed particularly to certain groups of fans.
Mods were big fans of the Yardbirds, and Eric was definitely a face, you know, as far as mods were concerned. Not all the other hairy arseholes in the band. I mean, they really were a shambles, that band, apart from Eric.
Grand buys you a guitar on the HP, and you know that it's different to actually getting given a guitar and saying, well, that's the end of that. Or, you know, I mean, Paul Samuel Smith had a Fender Stratocaster and he bought it. I mean, it was just like fell off a tree.
Now you know what a wee is? It's like a rolling stone. Every time she leave a man, grieving more. Whoa, the wee is. Why don't you hurry home?
He never wasn't really commercialised then. He didn't want to do anything about that sort of thing. As long as he lived and played his music, that's all he wanted, really. That's why he left the Yardbirds, because he was getting too commercial. He didn't want to.
I didn't like the way they were going. And I thought that it was all really just a joke for them. When I was actually fanatic at that point. Fanatic and wanting to get deeper and deeper and deeper into the blues. And they wanted to get lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter into what ended up as being 10cc type music. I mean, no offence, but, you know. And there was an ultimatum issued, and I said, well, OK, I'll leave. It's a mean old sea.
As suddenly as he'd left the Yardbirds, Clapton joined the Blues Breakers, a band committed to the blues and led by John Mayall.
I did use John as a vehicle, in a way, when I joined his band to express what I was feeling inside. I mean, I knew what Chicago blues playing was about, but it was still, there was something else inside me that had to come out.
His playing evoked the now famous response. Clapton is God slogans appeared everywhere. How did Clapton, still only 20, react to such heady acclaim?
Well, what can you do? What do you do?
Well, I don't know.
Well, you go around and scrub it off the wall. I mean, there's nothing you can do about it at all except just think, well, they've gone too far. You know, I'm not lumbering myself with that. There's no way. I mean, I never accepted the fact that I was the best guitar player in the world. I always wanted to be the best guitar player in the world. But that's an ideal. And I accept it as an ideal.
In 1966, he left the Blues Breakers to team up with bassist Jack Bruce and drummer Ginger Baker and form an ambitious trio, Cream. John Mayall had finally been too purist for him. Had he now abandoned the blues?
Well, it was a very quick step, wasn't it? I mean, from being with John Mayall, which was very, very, very textbook blues. You know, to going into a sort of jazz rock fusion band. I mean, that was jumping in the deep end of the pool. And so my conscience had to be affected by it in a way. And I thought it was going to be a textbook blues band. I had no idea of really what was going on inside those guys. And when we all got together, then I found out and I had to adapt. And suddenly I started learning. I learned mainly from Jack.
We invited Jack Bruce and Clapton to reunite. It was almost 20 years since they'd played together.
Give a damn about who liked what we did or whether or not it was going to be successful or not. We just had a great time playing with one another. But we were all just going in completely different directions half the time. Then we'd blend in and get together. But I was very, very happy there for a while.
What did you get from those two, then?
Positive electricity.
Cream emerged as strange and new, building their reputation during a long American tour. They were acclaimed in San Francisco as the first of the supergroups.
We were up against people like the Jefferson Airplane and Grateful Dead and, you know, Big Brother and the Holding Company, and they were struggling. They really were struggling. It didn't seem to me like any of them had ever listened to any of the proper records. You know, they'd all been kind of influenced by the Kingston Trio or something, weren't they? So we walked in there and just cleaned the place up. Every now and then at the Fillmore, you know, we'd get put on with B.B. King or Albert King or something like that, and then it was, OK, right, hold on, lads. Let's not overstep the mark here. This is the real thing. Boy, I love myself. If you leave me, my darling,
although this meeting was planned, the playing was completely unrehearsed. They hadn't played these old Cream songs since the band split up, and if the rustiness showed through, so did a little bit of the old understanding. How did these long solos that each of you do, how did they evolve? Was it by accident or design or...? Because of the three of you were so strong that you had to be on your own some of the time?
We simply couldn't stop playing.
Mm.
I mean, none of us was the band leader, so no one would say, stop, all right, enough. So if one of us took off, let him go. And we'd just go off that direction or go off the rat in that direction and see one another at the other end. Very rarely did it work. For me, very rarely. Very early on in the career of the band, of that particular band, that became our trademark. On many occasions it was like open warfare on stage. And the audience may have thought that it was like, you know, the newest raga or something, you know, it was really...
So on stage it was a competing and warring going on against each other, these three musicians?
Now and then. I'm not going to say all the time, but now and then, you know, it got to that,
So what goes through your mind when you're about to start a solo?
I go through all kinds of... I mean, and you've got a brief span of, like, 10 seconds before, you know, you've stopped singing and you think, right, I've got to play something now, and you go through 100 different changes in your head about what approach you're going to take. And usually, by the time you've gone through those changes, it's time, you see? And it's just like someone shoved you through a door and you've suddenly got to do an act. And you just start singing. For me, I just start singing.
In 1969, Cream self-destructed. If, for many, the band's breakup was regrettable, for the band members themselves, it was inevitable. Clapton and Ginger Baker briefly joined the ill-fated group Blind Faith. But Clapton soon left, retreating to his country home to recover from the public pressure and two personal tragedies. About 1970, when you withdrew really from musical life, from most sorts of social life. It's a part of your life that you have talked about. Was that partly prompted by the fact that your grandfather died that year, who was important to you, and Hendrix, who'd become a good friend, died at that time? Was that part of it? Was that part of the reason?
But you know, that's the first time anyone's ever pointed that out to me about my grandfather. That's very, very interesting. I'd never, ever thought about that before. He was without doubt a very, very important mainstay in my life. I mean, he was the original craftsman. I mean, he was a master plasterer, master bricklayer, master carpenter, a very quiet, humble man, very strong. And, yeah, it's never occurred to me before, but that may have been a time of grief, a time of mourning.
Clapton took refuge in the anonymity of minor bands, like Derek and the Dominoes. But it was while with them that he wrote his most successful song.
I was falling in love with Patty Harrison at the time, and it all equated somehow to me, or it seemed like it was an impossible quest. I mean, you don't fall in love with the wife of a Beatle. It's the last thing you do, especially in the late 60s or the early 70s. I mean, it's just not... It's not good form if you want to survive, you know.
The early 70s were a difficult time for Clapton. He became a virtual recluse in a life overshadowed by drug abuse.
Well, heroin's a very addictive drug. I mean, so that once you start taking it, it becomes part of your bloodstream, part of your system, so that when you run out, you need to get some more. I mean, I wasn't a suicidal case. I mean, I didn't want to die. I didn't want to disappear. I just wanted some peace and also some tranquility and some, obviously, a chemical was required to give me that in some way.
I mean, I remember hearing Eric say something about the fact that he, at one point, that he wanted to be like some of his heroes, you know, who were deadbeats living out of empty baked bean cans in the Delta. It's hard to work out what's going on, really. It's not Coleridge, it's not, you know... It's not the opium dens. It's something far more positive and destructive than that.
Well, who is it that said that the road of excess leads to the path of wisdom?
Blake.
Ah, that's it. Yeah, I believe in that. Yes, I think... But I think it's only for certain people. You see, I wouldn't recommend it to everyone.
He spent 3 years on that road until friends like Pete Townsend began to coax him back to work.
Hello, give me strength and carry on.
Well, the really favourite song I liked was The Lord Give Me Strength, because he got over that awful business, you know. And I often thank God he had the strength, you know. Because he had a fight with someone one day, and he said to me, I never win a fight. I said, never, never say that. I said, you won the hardest fight of your life when you gave up drugs. And he did, didn't he?
Dear Lord, give me strength to carry on.
Finally, he underwent Dr. Meg Patterson's black box treatment and came off heroin. He replaced his habit with hard work, taking only 2 weeks to translate 3 years of ideas and emotions into his comeback album, 461 Ocean Boulevard.
In fact, it wasn't even the songs itself, it was just all that emotion that had been just held down and like on the compost, you know, suddenly bursting forth.
I shot Sheriff.
461 Ocean Boulevard contained no guitar solos, but thoughtful songs and explorations of fresh musical areas like reggae.
I shot Sheriff.
His version of Bob Marley's I Shot the Sheriff became a number one single.
Yeah, I became more or less during most of the 70s, the early 70s and the mid 70s, more of a musicologist than a musician. I just was like a sponge absorbing as many different viewpoints as I could. And I got heavily into country music, but not the usual syrupy kind of stuff, but the very, you know, Don Williams things. Very, very laid back, very, very soft and gentle. And I settled there for quite a long time and tried to lay back and tried to be as economic as possible. And got severely criticised for it. They said it was all over, you know, that I couldn't play anymore. And when you open up your heart and your soul to an audience of people or onto a record, you're left with a void that is unbelievable. It's huge and it's and you're totally empty. And that is when you need nursing. You need something to calm the pain because you are suddenly, that's it, you've wrenched everything out. It's just like you've gutted yourself.
He filled the void with alcohol, lots of it.
The booze was just, I mean, it was actually part of the era too. I mean, I remember playing to crowds, you know, of like 20,000 people who were all completely out of their trees. Mm. And I was out of my tree, you know, and I did one gig laying flat on my back with the microphone laying down beside me. And they were quite happy.
You couldn't stand up.
Yeah, because I couldn't stand up. Well, I tried standing up to begin with. And then laid down and thought, well, they don't care, so why should I care? And they didn't care. They had a good time.
But when it sort of gets to one or two bottles of brandy a day, I mean, it's beyond having a good time. I mean, that's punishment, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, well, that's for your body can't take that. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and also I think it drives you crazy, too.
Yeah. So what was happening? Was your body not taking it? Were you going crazy?
Well, my body was actually starting to ulcerate inside. And I did actually end up in hospital as a result. And I'd started to get double vision. And I'd get 24-hour double vision. And if I lost the double vision, I'd panic. I mean, if things came into focus, I'd have to have a drink to get that double vision back, you see. Now, that is craziness.
We did a tour with Muddy Waters, and that meant quite a lot
exactly,
to you, I
understand. Exactly, yeah.
Why did that? Can you tell us a bit about why that seemed so important to you at that time?
Because it was my chance to get back to finding out what I was really supposed to be doing. And I still do it now and then, not with as much conviction, because there aren't that many people around left that you can tap into like that. I mean, but Muddy was, if you'd ever met the man, was almost like a kind of reincarnation of Buddha. You know, he was totally tranquil and very, very supportive, and he seemed to know that I was struggling for an identity, and he would just gently tap me in the right direction. There was one song he would always want me to play, which was called Worried Life Blues, which is a very old song by Big Maceo.
So
He also started writing film and TV theme music.
Loved doing that. It was so simple. It was like falling off a log because it was they sent me the first episode and it was just so dramatic that, well, it was, I just thought of, well, what should I do? It's like the theme of The Godfather, you know? I mean, it was just that simple, you know, just play along with the action.
He was in the control room and it was a typical film shoot situation that there was a TV on with the rushes running past with time code figures. And there was 10 people in the room. There was a guy on the phone, you know, oh, we've got to get the rushes for tomorrow, blah, blah, blah. Oh, for God's sake, you know, we've got to send them down. Put them in a bloody cab, blah, 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 blah. Somebody over here kind of saying, get the other roll up. How are we doing? Get more tea for me, Dorothy. Okay, Roland. Meanwhile, Eric is playing that music. And that was a take. And just really sublime, supreme playing.
That music won him two major awards, but it was a world away from Clapton's blues beginnings.
I think he must have left behind the spirit of blues, because unless he is, you know, you can't really play the blues unless you're in internal agony and turmoil and frustration and desperation. And I think now, even if something absolutely awful happened to Eric, I don't think he would necessarily respond in quite the same way again.
To play the blues, really, you have to have had some kind of emotional trauma, some kind of upset in your life, to have that yearning, you know. And then when you learn how to play it, then you suddenly realise that there are laws involving the structure of all that kind of music. And once you've got past that, it's just simply a question of starting and stopping. I mean, you know, it's second nature. It's very, very, it becomes easy. And it's the most satisfying form of music I find to play anyway.
Greatest pleasures are still solitary. Model cars, real cars, and days spent fly fishing.
I feel free.